Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the European LCS here live from Cologne. We're about to dive into SK versus Fnatic. But first, I'm joined by Lukas Schenke, who is the sports psychologist for SK Gaming. Now, Lukas, you're in a very unique position working with these players. So tell us what your day-to-day looks like.
Well, actually, it differs a lot. Sometimes, well, if you remind last split, if it's running, it's like a basic rule, never change your running system. And obviously now the times got hard for us, so I've got to work a little bit more. But it's not like that I do like the whole thing on my own. It's always a team effort, and I provide like know-how. So it's more of like a mutual agreement and mutual work rather than I design everything for them.
A joint effort. Well, you mentioned that it is a bit harder now because obviously they haven't had the best Super Week loss yesterday and now a very hard matchup for them today. So where do you come in specifically try and prepare them for a match like this?
Well, again, it always like differs. At the moment, I think we've got like issues more on a tactical level, not so much on a psychological level. I think on a psychological level, we are still strong. But in general, it's always important that you keep the mindset of losing is actually part of the game. It's important that you don't forget about that. And as long as you can like pull something good out of a loss, it's always valuable. So if you got that professional mindset and the players do have that, you make sure automatically, like almost, you get better. So even if we lose today, I'm always interested in the performance. This is what counts for me. It's not if we win or if we lose, but how we play the game. This is more my like piece of work.
Yeah, well, you talk about the professional mindset, and obviously you work a lot with people that are in traditional sports. How does that differ from working with a League of Legends esports team?
Ooh. Yeah, I could speak about that for hours, actually.
Go ahead.
No, I think the basic and main difference between traditional sports and esports is the physical thing. Obviously, you can, if you want, spam solo queue for the entire day or scrim for the entire day, which you can't actually in traditional sports. After 2 or 3 hours of playing soccer, you're exhausted. You don't have that. So how do you rate this advantage of having additional time? And when is the point reached where you say, okay, no, stop, we get burned out? So this is, I feel like, an important point to notice always, just to crunch on the surface.
Very interesting. Well, thank you very much and good luck in your matchup.
Yeah, thank you very much.
All right, so we're going to dive into that matchup, actually. So let's go over to our casters, D-Man and Trevor.
Thank you very much, Shox. It is finally time to get the last match of the week underway. It's a biggie, ladies and gentlemen. Fnatic versus SK Gaming. These teams have a huge history throughout esports, but currently in the European LCS Summer Split, their record is tied at 1-1. Fnatic have stepped up their performances lately, though, and are now on a 5-game win streak after they decimated the Super Hot Crew yesterday.
Yeah, so Fnatic pulled out a double AP comp yesterday, and they won with it after yelling at them all spring split long. Soez added another champion to his extensive champion pool, and he decimated Mimer in the laning phase. His Gragas ended 3-0-4, and I absolutely loved how he synergized with Cyanide to secure multiple kills. I think in general, Fnatic have just stepped up their game, they secured another strong victory, and if they continue this upward trend, they may be peaking at the right time with playoffs for world finals, world championships just around the corner.
Yeah, and they are feeling very confident when you talk to them as well. Of course, on the other side, SK Gaming are currently in a decline because they've lost their second spot in the league to Fnatic, which they've held, of course, for the last 5 weeks, as yesterday they were defeated at the hands of Rocket, who themselves have had a fantastic week. The problem is, they never really looked like they could win that game. Rocket were always the team being aggressive, and SK's late-game spirit that was pulling them through the matches back in the spring no longer seems to be there.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. SK have just not managed to keep up with the times. As the patches have rolled on, SK Gaming have seemingly gotten worse and worse. Now, it's a little difficult to purely blame the patch and the champion changes, especially when you consider it was Jezzers, who we talked about a lot, having problems, and his champions that were becoming less viable. The irony of yesterday's game is he was the only good player for SK Gaming. He pulled out Syndra for the first time. He went 4-4-2. If we step back for a little bit and look at SK's downtrend that has been happening for the last few weeks, I personally feel that Svenskeren and Candy Panda have not delivered. If you look at their stats individually, for the first 5 weeks, things look pretty solid. So let's start with Sven, for example. In the opening 5 weeks of the split, he went 33, 28, 75 in terms of kills, deaths, and assists. And in the last 3 weeks, he has a third of the kills, almost the same deaths, and half of the assists. He's not delivering or putting up the same stats or the same KDA. Candy Panda, it's a very similar story, but his is in fact worse. He has more deaths in the last 3 weeks than in the first 5. And if your AD carry is dying, it means your team is not protecting you. Or, as we've seen from Candy Panda in the last few games, he's just simply out of position. I think individually, the team is just not performing. And because their individual players are not putting up strong performances, their team play is suffering as well.
Well, for this match, Fnatic will, of course, be focusing on stopping SK Gaming in the early game to avoid letting their rivals achieve the dominant late-game teamfighting power.
Fnatic is a fine team. I think they will either win hard or they will just lose hard. Yeah, bot lane is really good. That's kind of their strength.
SK are really good at these like small advantages, like a buff, like countering buffs or taking a dragon when they're doing Baron and still managing to prevent the Baron. They're really good at making these calls and being able to come back into the games and also not let you come back.
They don't let the other team get anything for free, and even when they are behind, they kind of stall the game for a bit. And if you make a small mistake, since they are having good control on objectives, they will punish you super hard for it.
Fnatic is like, they play pick comps. They want to create picks. That's what they're good at with LeBonk, Twitch, TF, Trash. You can prepare really easy for that because they're not flexible. They will always do the same.
I think it's easier to read what they're doing and in terms of picks or strategies.
I think we've become much better at champion select and coming to the weeks where we were playing against Fnatic. We picked very poorly, and I don't think that will happen again.
The way to beat SK is just to beat them as a team, like in the lanes. 2v2, 1v1, you just beat them up because this is their weakness, that they don't have the best individual players in each role. But then again, if you don't do this, you will get outplayed as a team because they're so good together as 5.
I want to just add a comment to what Candy Panda was saying in the video. Is like, they have such good pick champions like Twitch, like Twisted Fate. The reason he's saying that is in week 4, it was Peke on Twisted Fate and Reckless on Twitch that destroyed them. Reckless went 10-1 and 10 in that game on Twitch. And it's definitely a flashback that they're looking to avoid. TF's going to be banned.
Yeah, I think it was 10-11 for Peke as well. Yep. It was a monster game for the two of them. Let's check out the starting lineups for these two teams as if you don't know them. On the blue side, it is Fnatic. And of course, that means Soaz, who is playing fantastically well in that top lane. Cyanide's in the jungle. Next, Peke in the mid lane. Reckless as AD carry. And Yellowstar in support.
Well, Yellowstar's Mohawk's not as good as mine. On the red side, it is SK Gaming with Freddy in the top lane, Svenskeren in the jungle, Jezzers playing the mid lane, Candy Panda and AD carry, and Enrated as the supports.
So we have a featured matchup for this match, ladies and gentlemen, and of course we're turning our attention to the bottom lane, but we're focusing on the supports to compare how Fnatic's ex-support and player Enrated, of course, is doing this split in comparison to the man who replaced him, Yellowstar.
Okay, so in every single metric, Yellowstar is outperforming Enrated. He's got 250 wards more placed, which obviously leads to better vision and an ability to make smarter calls. He also has higher kill participation, albeit a small one, and very importantly, he's got a higher number of assists per death. So while Yellowstar is obviously performing at his absolute best right now, Enrated is struggling, so it's a little unfair to contrast them. But if you think back to last split, when Enrated picked up his game after a few weeks in spring, he was leading SK Gaming to very strong victories. Enrated needs to do the same, and maybe the added pressure of playing against the team that benched him last year might be that extra drive that Enrated is looking for to deliver a strong performance.
We'll see how it works out between those two. Of course, there's no love lost, that's for sure, between those two players. Let's check out the numbers on loesports.com for this vote. No surprises, Fnatic fans are out in force. You've backed them for 87% of this one. It's a big, big vote, that's for sure, and the Fnatic fan base is huge in Europe.
Yeah, definitely. And you know what? In terms of performance, it's a 5-0 Fnatic that you're looking at coming into this game. SK got completely controlled and bullied yesterday. I do think we're going to see more of these mid lane bans from both of these teams. And We haven't seen a Maokai yet this week. The only reason I bring it up, if anyone in Europe is going to pull it out, I feel like it would be a Cyanide type of champion. He's such a supportive jungler. He really gives up a whole lot to his solo laners. And I wouldn't be surprised that if junglers were banned out, he would probably be the man that would pick it up. But that is a far goal, a stretch, I think.
We'll see how it works out, ladies and gentlemen. Pick and bans are about to get underway for this final game of the week. And it is a biggie. So, Caitlyn, the first ban from Fnatic. That tells me that maybe Reckless has something in mind against Candy Banner. Of course, Kassadin team taken away by the red team. You can buff and break Kassadin all you like, but he's still going to get banned out. Aatrox being the next ban. That's against Freddy. It's a champion who's been playing pretty confidently, and it's also a champion that works well against Gragas. So let's see whether Soaz wants to focus on that one. Of course, Twisted Fate going along with Sven Skeren's Lee Sin. Now, this may force something. What will the first pick be? That's the question. Will it be the mid, which sometimes they've done? There's a lot of top laners available. There's AD carry ban in there, so that may well focus on it.
Ziggs is still up there. Soaz played that in the top lane. Pekka's played that in the mid lane. Orianna's still available. It's
Another AD carry ban.
It's not as many mid lane bans that we've been seeing in the past. That's a very happy-looking Soaz. And I wonder if they're not just going to go with... I mean, if they banned out the AD carries, you could see Twitch is still available, Kog'Maw is still available. You could try and force SK onto, you know, a slightly different ADC. But this is a very unusual pick and ban phase because all of the trends from the rest of the games have been very heavily mid-focused. But you've still got a fair amount of mid-champions up and available for these two teams to run.
And this is the thing, while Fnatic may well get an important pick at the start, it gives SK two very big picks as well. Ziggs is the first pick. The question is, is it for that man on your screen right there, Soaz, or will it be for Peke? We will find out as the pick and bans continue. SK Gaming now, lots of options available. More importantly, Freddy, of course, with Aatrox taken away, where will he fall?
Yeah, I really don't know. Irelia is a possibility. Renekton is a possibility. The difficult thing for SK is, how do they go with the rest of their picks and bans, quite realistically, unsure where the Ziggs will go? Because of the psychological doubt that Fnatic have instilled in SK's mind, they need to pick safe champions. And Gragas is probably a smart pick because Jezzes has played it a bunch in the past. We've just seen two games back-to-back where it's been mid lane, and then three of the previous five games it was top lane. So SK have countered the multi-lane Ziggs with a multi-lane Gragas and said, we're calling your bluff, it's now your turn to reveal something.
It's going to be a jungle, it seems. Of course, Morgana was selected in there. That's Enraith, and that's our featured matchup. We'll see how that one goes out. Lock in very quickly. That's going to be a Thresh for Yellowstar, so we know what the supports are playing. And of course, Cyanide goes with Evelynn. Evelynn always picked over Elise as well for Cyanide.
Yes, and he's doing very well with that champion. Makes very good use of her invisibility. And I think the reason it's very important against a team like SK, their vision game has faltered extensively over the last 2 weeks. In Super Week, I do not feel that their vision was particularly strong. They had a 21-minute surrender from Alliance. They're also placing less wards per game on average than they have in previous weeks. You could argue it is because they have been controlled and they have been, I'm going to use this word, they've been stomped more frequently, which of course leads to less wards. But regardless of the thought pattern, SK needs to ensure they have superior vision control, or they will get flanked by Evelynn.
You need a good bit of visioning.
Visioning.
Vi is a potential here for Sven Skeren. Not a champion we've seen him playing too often, but of course, Rockat did run it for Jankos against Alliance earlier on, and they managed to single out the AD carry a number of times in that game to great effect. Candy Panner, of course, he's going to be useful. There's Phosphorus Bombs. Been checking out Cyanide, keeping vision on him, maybe. But we'll see how that works, of course, with two AD carries banned away. It gives Reckless a short choice of champions.
Kog'Maw, Twitch, I think, are some of the possibilities on his shortlist. In terms of, you know, the SK composition, they've got very, very strong engage. They've got very strong disengage with that Gragas. And the trend that you tend to see from red side is mid lane pick lost. With Orianna still up, with Syndra still up, with Fizz still up, SK could actually pick any one of those and it would change the context of the composition. If they run something like a Fizz, they've got a very heavy pick comp. If they run something like an Orianna, they've got a team fight AoE composition.
Well, what was the champion that Fnatic used to play long ago when Reckless was just a wee nipper in nappies playing against the likes of CLG's Doublelift.
That's a bit of a stretch. He wasn't that young.
Of course, Vayne. He was 15, for Christ's sake, and he was in Vegas. Who goes to Vegas when you're 15?
Well, who wears nappies in Vegas, which is what you're implying.
Well, actually, now that you bring that up, let's not go down. Shyvana picked in. That's what we want to know. So as in there, that does mean, of course, Ziggs is in the mid lane, but we do see Orianna as the final choice for Jezzes, which forces Gragas into the top lane for Freddy.
Okay, so Wombo combo team composition on the side of SK Gaming and a whole lot of magic damage. Gragas, Orianna, and even Corki, who is mixed, means that Fnatic are going to need to invest in a fair amount of MR fairly early on. For Fnatic, they've got very good wave clear, and they've got very good split pushing. With Shyvana and Vayne, they can play the 1-3-1 game very effectively. And because of the fact they have Evelynn as a jungler, SK Gaming always need to calculate, if we engage, is Evelynn there? Is Evelynn going to counter-engage? So for SK Gaming, they don't really want to put themselves in a position where they're being pushed around the map. But they can deal with split push because Orianna and Gragas have got safe, reliable wave clear. Both teams can do things fairly effectively, but if Fnatic get grouped up, the Wombo Gombo power of SK is very strong. They need to be wary.
Well, after an important, interesting, different pick and ban phase, very different from what we've seen so far this week. Let's see how this turns out. With the featured matchup, of course, on the supports, who do you think will dominate this duo lane? It was Thresh for Yellowstar versus Morgana for Enrated. Of course, they're in. AD carries alongside them are pretty important in that matchup. Tweet us at LOL Esports and use the hashtag Yellowstar or hashtag Enrated. Remember, that's a zero, not an O in there.
That is it.
Well, it's an O, not a zero. It the other way around. Yeah. I know what I meant.
Yeah, we'll just read the graphic and go with that. We'll see how this plays out because, you know, we've only seen one lane swap this weekend and it was Alliance that tried that one yesterday against Millennium.
Yeah, I didn't work
it out. It didn't work out particularly strong, but it was also a testament to the rest of the champions and how they played because Wicked put himself quite far behind. I'm interested to see if either Fnatic or SK go for that because Vayne can theoretically get poked by Corki fairly early on thanks to the Phosphorus Bomb. So we need to see how Candy Panda handles himself on this Corki.
Ironically, I talked to Wicked about that game and he said, yeah, you can do it either two ways when you 2v1. You either wipe out the wave quickly or you get it on the second wave. We didn't either. Yes. We just left it and like both lanes and we just said we completely screwed up from the beginning. So they knew we were in trouble early on. Nevertheless, we're into this match. It is the final game of the day. Fnatic, of course, chasing hard on Alliance who've lost two games this week. Fnatic, of course, chasing a six-game win streak here.
The only way that this could work out. Fnatic also setting up for a potential lane swap. But we need to see if Freddy gets hooked.
Well, we'll see. I don't think he's going to. He's going to step away from that one. Could belly slam away. He's got Flash as well, of course. SK Gaming, how are they going to turn things around? We just heard from their sports psychologist, who apparently doesn't matter whether you win or lose. But nonetheless, he managed to put a bit of a tilt on it and basically say they got to make sure they don't get burnout. Maybe burnout isn't a problem for SK Gaming. Maybe that's why they had a great spring and maybe coming in towards the summer, the final sprint, Fnatic, who always come out on top are the ones that are ahead of SK now.
Well, if burnout is the cause of SK Gaming's problems, then they've definitely focused their energy at a less opportune time of the year. With so few weeks to play before the playoffs for the 2014 World Championships, now is the time to start upping your game and fixing your practice regimens. Regardless, 10 minutes before the 2-minute mark, minions are hitting the middle lane. It does still give me the inkling that Reckless and Yellowstar will be setting themselves up for a lane swap. And you have to imagine it is because of that Vayne-Corki matchup. In theory, Corki can punish hard. We've seen in the previous game just how effectively Woolite shut down a Lucian. And Vayne has an even weaker laning phase than Lucian at this stage. So lane swaps, and we'll see who comes out ahead.
Lane swaps, and of course, we've had the red buff traded, which was cleared out by Fnatic, but not by SK. They've left the wee little minion up in that red buff area, which is going to cause potentially some timing problems for Fnatic. We'll see how that one trades across as they both move back across the blue buff. So, as you can see, Reckless and Yellowstar are indeed in a 2v1 situation up against Freddy, who on Gragas shouldn't have too many problems. Of course, he now has longer range on the experience. It's now 1400 instead of 1250 that it used to be. We are on the 4.11 patch, of course, that you guys at home are all playing it.
Yeah, and of course, if Cyanide wants to go for the likes of a tower dive, you can see Soaz as well as Cyanide making their way top. They need to be careful of the turrets. It is 4.11, turret damage is higher and hits its max cap after two shots instead of three. I also want to highlight the fact that Yellow Star started with a relic shield. We'll see how quickly he sells that and goes towards the ancient coin. It is pretty normal.
Ooh,
Cyanide wasn't
good.
Spotted. Cyanide wasn't spotted, and Soaz got in.
Soaz had got in around before that warp. Death Center's not going to land. Minion wave, though, will be pushed in. There is a minion wave coming in behind this one. This could be a 4v1 dive. Freddy has got flash available. I think he realizes it's coming. There goes Reckless, condemns him on the wall, stuns him up there. Reckless is actually tanking the tower damage. He's going to come in for the final hit. He doesn't get it. Cyanide taken very low, but nonetheless, it's Soaz that gets the kill.
Yeah, but look at the response from SK Gaming. They instantly pull their Jaw Lane up into the dragon pit, and they should be securing this dragon. So dragon gold will be worth more than first blood at that early stage of the game. So I think a pretty smart reaction, but Fnatic definitely showing an indication to get their AD carry farmed and ahead, and they secure that first blood.
So Freddy teleports back to top, and it was a trade, honestly, in favor of SK Gaming at the end of the day, because they get that dragon, and it's always the problem when you do go for this. And of course, nevertheless, Soaz got himself the level, got himself the kill, which now going back down towards that 2v1 lane will give him the double longsword. But at the moment, he's not looking interested in joining that 2v1.
So look at it this way. Even though SK got the dragon, oh, look at this, Freddy sidesteps. It is Fnatic that got the first blood onto Soaz. The reason that is important, if Soaz is able to get to a position where he can bully Freddy, or he can split push at an earlier stage of the game, then Fnatic can dictate the tempo. They can pull resources to try and stop Soaz and then go for the next dragon themselves or push ulterior objectives. So it's very important for Fnatic to take advantage of where their gold is sitting, and it'll be on Soaz's shoulders to make that happen.
Soaz and Cyanide moving in for round two. This time around, they've got support. Svenskeren just off of the side instead. They may focus on towards him. Svenskeren spots them. And Freddy now in trouble, condemned onto the tower this time. He's going to try and slip away. He's got the support of Svenskeren. He should escape safely.
Yeah, he does manage to get away. So the pressure of Sven and the fact that the minion wave was going to be a while before hit the tower, that siege minion is slowing Fnatic's minions from pushing up. It does mean that Soaz is missing out on some XP. Freddy is getting a lot of solo experience thanks to that range increase. And you can see he's got a two-level advantage over Soaz, which at this stage of the game is very important. It's not necessarily about gold, it's about your effective levels. And Soaz is a full half experience bar away from hitting level 3. So we need to see how he plans on getting himself back into this game, because the roaming is doing okay for the time being, but Alliance tried it yesterday and failed. This is very reminiscent of the Alliance lane swap. They moved around the map, they tried to tower dive. Alliance didn't get any kills, so already Fnatic are a step further, but they are behind an experience.
Look at this, so as they know he's teleporting down here, Svenskeren immediately comes around, he's gonna catch him with this barrage. Will he do enough damage? He will, he locks him up there. Oh, flashes away from Soaz there. Good play from SK Gaming. They knew exactly, read that situation like a book. And it's caused all sorts of problems. Soaz,
Mega
Inferno Bomb, that's going to wipe out the way. It's going to save the tower for now. But Soaz, he's going to go back, surely.
Yeah, this is so reminiscent of yesterday's game. Alliance just played such a mobile game, I feel, with their champions moving around the map. Finally, that red buff is being reset. That is very, very late. I mean, red buff should have been respawning within the next minute and a half or 2 minutes. And now it's going to be a full respawn timer away. For Fnatic, I think they need to find a way to get themselves back into a slightly more standard setup, which is why Soaz is now hanging around in lane. He wants to get those levels. And with his double Dorans, if he gets the support of Peke or Cyanide, there is a lot of damage that could go down onto either Candy Panda or Enrage.
The thing is, we've been talking about how Soaz is so happy with the current meta, the current patch setup, and yet here he is back on Shyvana, back in a style that actually he didn't like. This is what he didn't agree with, and maybe SK have been very clever in their pick and ban phase to put him maybe in an uncomfortable position. You can see it's a big, big difference right now. He's still got that two-level gap. He's still only got 9 CS. He's got that kill, of course, early on against Freddy, but overall, he's a long way behind.
Yeah, he really is. Did just hit level 4, but he'll still be by level 3/4 away.
Even on gold, by the way.
Look at this invade now from Fnatic. The first blood's very important. He did get that before level 4, and it scales slightly quicker now. That's a great death hit.
The red playoff is what they're fighting for. I'm not sure Cyanide's going to get it. Freddy comes in there, tries to get on. It's a good shockwave. Cyanide taken low. Enrated flashes for it. Freddy comes in. Nobody going down yet. But there's Peke. Gets himself one onto Freddy. The first, second kill, for Fnatic. Reckless got caught out with the dart binding. Red buff was also stolen away. So while Fnatic have been having a little bit of interesting lane phase at the start, they still come out on top.
Just superior skirmishing. They landed the abilities they needed to, and they focused the right target down. Freddy, who was level 5, didn't have the displacement of that explosive cast, really just got, you know, squashed by all of the Fnatic presence. You can't deny the fact that Jezzers had a good shockwave. It made things a little hairy, a little scary for Fnatic. But they had a lot of support, and their numbers advantages in the top half of the map, because they did have their AD carry, they did have their support there. So Fnatic, 2-0. They have a small gold lead, despite losing that first dragon, but they should be aware of the timer. So I'm interested to see if Fnatic or SK try to rush this next dragon as it spawns, especially when you consider SK have got their duo bottom. They do have the numbers to play with.
And while all the fancy play that they've been doing, well, they had that skirmish, Freddy went down, so has gained himself 2 levels, back on even ground. So Fnatic back in this game. We talked about SK's weak early game. They almost had it there, but again, it's been a little bit juked out of place. Freddy shoving this wave up as hard and fast as he can. He wants to go back and get himself some items, but Reckless comes straight back in, gets himself that proc going off there. Will be enough to force him away. We did see Catalyst the Protector being picked up by Freddy though, so he should be safe for now.
Yeah, so he's got a lot of sustain as well in that lane. And while Freddy lost the lead he had over Soaz, Yellow Star still maintains the level advantage over Enrated. Enrated only just hit level 4, and Yellow Star is getting much closer towards that level 6. We'll see how quickly he can get up there. And it looks like he's also putting some vision around the Dragon Pit. Look at the amount of Fnatic wards on the map in contrast to SK. Fnatic are going to have much more information to play with, especially around the Dragon Pit. They're aware they lost the first dragon, and they've got the tools in place to either challenge or steal the next one.
So Dragon is up. SK took the last one. Let's see whether SK can bully them out. They don't really have the number advantage this time around. You can see Fnatic got 4 members down here. Pit Ward will get spotted out. Sorry, it's a normal ward down there. Yellowstar throws out on Candy Panda.
So cheeky. But that is one of the tricks you can do. Completely psyching out Candy Panda. And this next Dragon fight is going to be very interesting. Not just Reckless and Yellowstar have moved themselves into the bottom lane. Both teams can actually do very well in the Dragon Pit, but the pressure is going to be on SK Gaming to be on the same page, because Orianna's ultimate and Gragas's ultimate are counterproductive. They do not help each other. However, if you pull everyone together, deal the damage, and then split them up to focus single targets, it can work well. It just adds extra layers of complexity to SK Gaming's team fights, and they're a team who have not had good team fights in recent weeks. So we need to see if they've solved their problems against Fnatic in the next big engagement.
So, what was our featured match? It was the two supports at the moment. It's Yellowstar who has the edge, 100% kill participation. Of course, with those
two assists.
Yeah, 2 full levels as well. He's very much ahead and rated. He's been trying to roam, trying to counter. And again, this time putting the pink ward down there. The dragon being started off. Maybe an advantage could be gained here, but look at the mid lane. Peke actually has that wave shoved up, so this is risky play for SK, because they could potentially A, lose a lot of damage on that mid turret, and B, lose the Dragonfire anyway.
Both top laners have teleports available, and you can see the tentative nature of both of these teams. You know, either team can win a fight in those close spaces, and it just comes down to, you know, positioning. So we may see a standoff. It may be a slightly delayed dragon, because of the high risk involved. And Svenskeren's got his ultimate now. With the Vi, you really want to start getting engaged and getting those kill set up. So if he can combo with a kill onto Peke or a kill onto Reckless, that could allow SK Gaming to go for a slightly safer dragon. And I think that would probably be the way to go forward. Combo yourself with either the mid or the bottom lane and have the numbers advantage for the objective.
Bottom lane pairing now going at it. One head to head, Reckless has to take some damage. Didn't actually take the shield from Yellowstar, and it won't be forced away. That may be enough for SK to try and trigger this one. Pink Ward will spot that cheeky ward in the back there. The Yellow Star immediately replaces it. That's going to get cleared out. It's going to be a 4v4 if they go for this one. Sentence landed from Yellow Star and a grain. Another fake.
Very, very smart, actually. By aggroing the dragon, it just forces Svenskeren to take damage. Look at the engage. Reckless is late to the party, but the Mega Inferno Bomb is up. Fnatic, they want to contest.
Mega Inferno Bomb only catches on Jez. It's a hook on Enrated. Support, support. Svenskeren goes way too deep with the Vault Breaker and gets caught straight out and taken down. Now with the jungler down, Fnatic going to push their advantage here. Enrated forced to flash away. And just like that, top lane is not required. Fnatic going to take themselves their first dragon of the game.
Very, very well played. The counter engage from Fnatic. It's not over though, as Candy Panda's got a good mana bar and he's spamming rockets, but it does feel very low. Oh, he's been caught.
Candy Panda playing a risky game there. He saw the satchel charge bouncing him away. Could have bounced him easily the opposite direction. Dragon was picked up by Fnatic. Now that gives them a 1500 gold advantage while the top laners continue to duke it out.
So that was a 4v4, and Jez has really had no presence in that fight. He was fairly low on mana. We did not see the shockwave coming down. And as Reckless was able to engage from the side, pulled into the fight by Yellow Star, SK was just full retreat. So Fnatic grabs themselves a 2000 gold lead, and they've regained control. They've regained the tempo of this game. They were pushing top. They were diving Freddy. They were invading red. And now they're taking the second dragon away. SK Gaming are starting to fall behind, are starting to slip. And it's what happened yesterday as well.
Slowly slipping away from them. Top lane, Soaz now has the creep score advantage built up over Freddy, of course, along with that kill advantage he built up from the very start. Svenskeren going for an invade here. Vault Breaker was charged up at Peke with very little mana. He needs this blue buff, which looks like it's going to be invaded and taken by SK. Svenskeren instead is going to make his move towards that top lane.
No ulti.
No ulti available. Doesn't have a salt battery, but he could try and force something from Soaz, who actually sidesteps the Vault Breaker, uses his own ultimate. Oh, good explosive cast though coming out. And now Soaz is in trouble. Has to flash away. There's going to be Mega Inferno Bomb. It's going to bounce on down, but it's not going to be enough damage. And Soaz drops.
Yeah, manages to just get squashed by Freddy and Svenskeren. Pretty smart play from Soaz. He actually managed to sidestep the Vault Breaker and then Dragon's Descent backwards. The only problem was he took both of his opponents with him in the distance. So SK managed to secure. Now Yellowstar jumped on.
Yellowstar focused. Is he going to go down here? Each shield's not going to be enough. That's a good Dark Binding from Enrated. Finally captured on with the Soul Shackles down, but he's in trouble. Reckless turns the attention back towards him and gets himself a kill.
Yeah, so they trade one for one. Yellowstar maintains his 100% kill participation, and SK Gaming focusing the support. It's something you should never do. Now, Assault and Battery is available. This is a 2v2 in the mid lane, and you've seen Svenskeren using the Sweeping Lens to clear out the vision. Look at Cyanide from the sidelines. Fnatic should be aware of this because Svenskeren was clearing a ward out, but he's far away. He's going to take time to react, and they've caught Jez.
They've caught on towards him. He's had to use the flash already. He gets slowed down, but he's quick away from that one, of course. No Mega Inferno Bomb available. It was used just a moment ago, nor Ignite for Peke, so they didn't go full on for it.
Yeah, Candy Pan has a small level advantage over Reckless, and in that fight, they bursted down Yellowstar pretty quickly. End up coming away with Candy Pan and Reckless with one kill apiece, but obviously Reckless is going to have the dueling advantage in a straight up fight. He's got the Blade of the Rune King completed, he has the tumble, he has that, you know, big heal that he can get from the active of Blade. And obviously, Candy Pan is just looking to poke him down. But I do want to highlight, Yellowstar did sell his Relic Shield. He picked himself up that Ancient Coin. He's had it for a little while, I believe. And it's just something Yellowstar is doing, I think, that no other Threshers are doing in Europe. Consistently valuing the movement speed from Talisman of Ascension so, so highly.
Yeah, seeing how it works out for them. At the moment, it's working wonders. Fnatic 4-2 up in kills, and just a 1,500 gold lead still standing. And Rated's going to get himself a bit of gold there as his AD carry Candy Panda returns to lane. Reckless Dark Binding, I think, landed. Yep, there it is. In the fountain. Doesn't do a great deal, though.
It was a takeaway Dark Binding.
Svenskeren waiting off on the side there. Mega Inferno Bomb wipes out the wave from Peke. That's going to be on cooldown. We did see that. Jezzes would have caught a glimpse on it. And there is the red buff finally, of course, respawning for a second time after that long delay at the start. Peke not letting Jezzes back away.
So Fnatic have got the key items sort of being worked towards. Soaz got the makings of his Blade of the Rune King. Reckless has had his built for a little while. And I think if any team is going to be successful at a 1-3-1, it's going to be Fnatic because of how phenomenal they were at side lane pushing last year and at how much experience they have at split pushing and playing the objectives on the map.
Good movement here from SK Gaming. They've just took the bottom tower down. Look at it, straight in towards the red jungle. Fnatic themselves, they're up in the top half. There's only two here. They could move in towards the mid lane. Peke's ultimate not available. Everybody else moving three members in towards their Reckless. Looks like he could get that first turret of the game for Fnatic. Meanwhile, SK keep on moving for this mid.
Yeah, but the wave clear from Peke is very, very high. So all of the minions are instantly down. The rest of SK have set their sights on Soez. There's no flash available.
Oh,
Soez does have Dragon's Descent. Can SK lock him down? We're about to find out.
Svenska and Voltbreaker catches on towards him. Assault Battery is available if he needs it, but he is going to lock on towards him. Soez in trouble. No flash available. Dragon Descent, but he gets caught and clipped on the wings by Candy Panda.
So not enough vision from Fnatic there really to cover it down. SK just run to the bottom lane. So I was a sticky run. I actually see a pink ward in the red buff jungle there of Fnatic, and so as little uncharacteristic there being caught in a side lane push, but you can see it is the strategy Fnatic want to be doing. Soez has got a whole bunch of gold. He's still working towards that blade. I actually think he's got enough money to finish it. We'll see if he decides to go that route. We do see, once again, Death Sentence missing.
Blue Invade coming in here, but it's Svenska in their court out. The jungle is in all sorts of trouble. It gets exhausted down. Cyanide will take that one, comboed with Yellowstar, who is still on 100% participation.
So much damage from Cyanide. He's got the Spirit of the Elder Lizard. He's got a Hexdrinker completed. And
Death Sentence again. Jez is now Mega Inferno Bomb, not quite enough, but that's going to force him away from the tower, and it should be Fnatic that will take it.
Yeah, and again, it's just a vision game. Cyanide hanging out in the bushes. He's not spotted by SK. It allows Yellowstar to back him up and get that kill. So they get a lot of damage onto that mid turret from SK, and Fnatic, with presence and numbers and hit points, they secure the dragon and another tower.
So big swing for Fnatic this time around, and it's the support and jungler working around Death Sentence. Well, he got himself Barry White there, but I'm not too sure it was Candy Panda who was aiming at.
Not this time around. Definitely wanted to just get a quick single under his belt, and Barry White manages to get secured by SK. So Fnatic, they're dictating control in the jungle. They've invaded red multiple times. They just invaded blue to secure kills, and Fnatic are again taking advantage of the poor vision from SK. Every single time I've looked at this minimap, SK Gaming have had little to no wards on the map. And in the bottom half, actually across the entire map, there are only three wards down. One pink and two greens. And it's simply not enough vision against an Evelynn who's going to be moving around, and especially a Fnatic team that is invading your jungle. All right, so bottom lane, we do see Fnatic backing away. Sven's about to get an Assault and Battery, and they've set their sights on Soez in the top lane.
Yeah, top lane is getting poked out. Soez, though, Dragon's Descent away from that one. Not get caught out this time around by the duo partnership of SK Gaming. He's going to get support as well. Cyanide making his way up there. SK rotating in towards the mid lane. A lot of pink wards, as you mentioned, though. A lot of wards across the board, honestly, for Fnatic. That's giving them full vision of the whole situation.
So I do want to say that oh, that's a great hook. Not much support from the rest of Fnatic.
Ooh, Peke's in trouble.
Well, we'll see if they're going to dive him. There's so many members around, but there is a lantern available for Peke if he needs it. What I want to highlight, if Fnatic get grouped up and get stuck together, a Shockwave, Cask, and Corki damage can help SK win some fights. They are 3,000 gold down. It is not game-changing at 20 minutes. And their 5v5 power is very strong. The key will be for Svenskeren to lock down Peke or Reckless and remove them from a fight very quickly.
It's funny, really, you know, we're talking about obviously the vision wards that SK have right now. We've heard about how Fnatic are very good at using that darkness, using that lack of vision that you sometimes have. And when you don't have a ward down, of course they're going to be good at it because you simply don't see it coming right now. Mega Inferno Bomb, oh, not going to quite steal it away from Jezzers. Just a little bit too late. The Nunu is over there, though. Reckless himself, he's going to go back and bite. He's got himself the Yomu's Ghostblade down, and that's putting himself in an important situation, and I think it may well trigger Fnatic to start pushing towers.
I don't think anybody can 1v1 him on the side of SK Gaming. There's nowhere near enough tankiness on Svenskeren. There's a giant's belt on Freddy, and it looks like Freddy's going to get caught out. He's coming in from behind. Cask and Flash is available. Can he pull off some fancy footwork?
Well, he was trying to back away. He has teleport available. Flay doesn't land. It doesn't matter. They don't need it. Explosive Cask, Flash, and away he goes.
Fancy footwork indeed. Very good play from Freddy. It actually shows he's got a fair few Gragas games under his belt. Very controlled. didn't look like he panicked. The numbers advantage in the mid lane also means SK can secure themselves a almost turret.
No, good clearance from Peke there.
Yeah, very good wave clear. So Fnatic hold on to the objectives. They did burn Freddy's flash in the top lane. Cyanide was looking at coming in from the side lanes. I was saying there's not enough armor or hit points on SK's side to deal with Reckless, who has a Ghostblade and Blade of the King. So look at how far and how deep Fnatic's Reckless is pushing. As long as there's sight of SK, he should feel safe and relatively confident in this lane.
Yeah, Reckless keeping on pushing, so as pushing down the bottom lane. SK, they've desperately been grouping in towards this mid tower. They want to try and take away that vision that Fnatic have. Another pink ward cleared out. Cyanide will do the same with Yellow Star, and SK are forced back again and cannot siege down this turret.
Look in the top lane.
Oh, Freddy in trouble. One more hit. Reckless going to gamble in for it. Tumbles in and gets himself a kill. And that is the top laner duo.
Honestly, that was obvious. I mean, with the Ghostblade and Blade of the Rune King, there's no way Freddy was going to survive.
Didn't even use the blade.
He didn't have, Freddy didn't have his ultimate, nor didn't he have Flash. He had just lost or been ganked in the top lane. He needed to have played safer. So Reckless punishes, the rest of Fnatic group up, and they're getting a lot of damage on this inner turret.
Yeah, and that's going to be the wave pushed in. You can see Fnatic all moving into position. SK not responding to this one. They're still in the jungle. They're waiting for the push because they can see, they know that Peke is in the mid lane. They know that Soez is down the bottom. They're thinking, oh, well, they can't surely be going for this tower. Well, yes, they are. Reckless and Cyanide beat it down. That's half the hit points gone.
50% of that top inner turret down just from a single kill that Reckless secured a few minutes ago. And the whole setup for that, Reckless was alone in the top lane, Soez was alone in the bottom lane, and the three members of Fnatic with the peel and wave clear, with the peel from Thresh and the wave clear from Ziggs, they're able to defend against SK quite effectively. They call Freddy.
Freddy caught once again. Death sentence this time around. His bites go down. Reckless is coming in. And it's Cyanide that will take the kill.
Cyanide just kill secures that one for sure. Svenskeren's moving in, but you feel for naught because tower is already gone. And Fnatic take a third tower of the game. This map is completely theirs. SK needs more vision, and they need to rely on Svenskeren's engages to actually get some points on the board. I don't think, other than one kill on Soez who was overextended, Sven has been very impactful on this Vi at all. And please keep in mind that Elise was open. Elise was available, and he picked Vi over Elise.
So AD carries both doing a fantastic job, but the featured was Yellowstar and Enraten, and clearly right now it's Yellowstar that's coming out way ahead. No longer 100% kill participation, no, because Reckless decided to solo Freddy. It's a bit rude of him, didn't invite Yellowstar up to that top lane. Wasn't really required. Dragon up in 2 seconds, and Fnatic in full position. Uh-oh, Death Sentence flung out there towards Svenskeren. Torches out to the side of it. Enraten may well get caught out now. He's trying his best to stop Fnatic, but look at this. Five-man group, they're ready.
SK need a perfect team fight. If they want to close this 4,000-5,000 gold gap, they need to get multiple ultimates on multiple members of Fnatic, because Fnatic can just play the map. They can play the side lane push, and SK has little to no answer other than wave clearing under a turret. But the moment they make one small misstep, they get caught out.
Look how confident Yellowstar is. Hooked straight in there, flays on towards it. There's the Mega Inferno Bomb catching on Jezzes. And immediately they force SK back. The confidence of Yellowstar literally walking in the face of that top laner.
It was very brave as well, because Fnatic were quite split. They didn't have the tightest of groupings, and the recall was in fact cancelled there. So may have been a small bait. No Mega Inferno.
Oh,
look
wow.
at the damage.
And Enraten in all sorts of trouble. That's Blade of the Rune King doing its work there. The rest of their team, Freddy locked up. He goes down. Shockwave pulls in the AD carry, but he doesn't really care. A Volt Breaker and Assault Battery used on towards Reckless, but he just turns that back around and gets himself a kill. Now Enraten's running for his life, and it was a 2-0 to Fnatic. They just move on down and take that dragon with ease.
Svenskeren took far too long to get involved. Jezzes landed a good shockwave onto both Peke and Reckless, but Svenskeren wasn't committed to the fight. He felt, probably, that the fight was lost. Fnatic landed a good death sentence onto Freddy. Enraten was forced so low by that bite of Soaz, and SK were in full retreat. So another dragon goes the way of Fnatic, another buff from SK goes the way of Fnatic. And this game is quickly becoming out of hand for SK. Nobody can contain Reckless. I feel nobody can contain Soez. He's got 2,300 gold. Peke was sitting on 3,000 gold himself. So a lot more items to be picked up. And this item or statistic advantage is going to grow even further.
And the thing is, for me, I feel that from the very beginning, they knew there was going to be a 2v1 situation, and then I guess SK were kind of happy with that, but I feel like they needed to put a bit more pressure onto Reckless. They knew he had to be pushed in. He had to have that 2v1 situation. He couldn't go into 2v2. So could they have just lane swapped? Could we have the lane swap dancing that we've seen often before?
I feel that Yellowstar was anticipating it, because when he's not had lane swaps, he goes Ancient Coin. And when he is in a 2v2 setup, he goes Relic Shield with Thresh. And because Yellowstar picked up the Relic Shield, he may have been anticipating a 2v2 battle. SK never went for it. And unfortunately, Svenskeren's had no presence this game.
I don't feel
that Svenskeren's assault and batteries have been impactful at all. And SK have not been able to really solo out targets or find Fnatic members to kill, because they've also been defending the whole time. Fnatic invaded red buff multiple times in the first 15 minutes. They invaded SK's blue buff twice in the last 10 minutes. And it's just been all about Fnatic moving around the map and SK being forced to react and instead of being proactive.
See how they react to Fnatic right now as they start to slowly close out and suffocate SK Gaming's map. You can see the Vision Ward control. Mega Inferno Bomb thrown down towards the bottom wave. Still yet to take that out of turret, by the way. But Fnatic, they're moving in. Soaz caught out, but the rest of Fnatic are reacting to this one. Soaz might be able to get away with the Dragon Descent over towards the Tri-Bush. He is clear. Yellowstar throws out the hook, lands it on Svenskeren, follows it through, throws down. Quick Lantern comes out, Reckless joins the party. Vaultbreaker and Assault Battery on towards him, but Svenskeren once again focuses Reckless and pays the price with his life. Freddy goes down, double for Reckless, triple for Reckless, and he's just cleaning up SK Gaming right now.
Soaz gets away with his life, and that was all started thanks to Yellowstar. He lands a death sentence, he pulls the support of Reckless over the wall, and Reckless just melts through SK Gaming. Fnatic now look like they're setting up for Baron with Blades of the Ruined King. You see Soaz is healed. He's teleporting in. This is an uncontested 29-minute Baron after multiple kills. Fnatic in absolute flawless control. They're looking to make it 6-0.
Dominant performance. The win record could well be continuing here. Fnatic Chase Alliance at the top of the table. Look at this though.
So well played. Reckless manages to come over the wall thanks to a very well positioned Lantern from Yellowstar, and because of the fact that he's actually out of range of enrated Soul Shackles, he's just able to clean up. And Soaz even manages to survive the ignite thanks to another Lantern.
And if you noticed, actually, it was Reckless over the wall that condemned him against the wall. Oh, Becky! Hey, up! Rollo is a quick alley up over the wall and catches him. Gets a little chuckle for that one. I think he enjoyed it. But back to Reckless. He used that condemn, and that's actually what saved Soaz. He knocked him away from Soaz. And Soaz is safe. So again, another fantastic performance. And Fnatic now starting to pull on a bit of a show, I feel.
You have to question, how is it Fnatic can pull these moments out with 3 weeks before playoffs, but not earlier in the split? What is it that is happening during Super Week and now in Week 8 that is bringing this level of coordination and this level of control? Because we're not seeing it. Yellowstar has got the biggest grin on his face because
he's the giggles.
You can't blame him. They're 13-3 up against SK Gaming, which is one of Fnatic's longest standing rivals in every esport for many, many years. And this has just been all about Fnatic. It's the Fnatic show, and there's little that SK can do to stop them.
Yeah, they are unable to react to this one. And honestly, what is it that pulls them out? I don't know. They were Season 1 World Champions, of course. On that team was only two members back then. That was, of course, Cyanide and XPeke. But they are a team that does always deliver. There's a reason they've won three splits running. Could they make it four? Who knows? They're starting to step up. That is not a bomb.
We didn't see it. We didn't see it.
Signify a three-season winning mid laner, that's for sure.
Well, he's getting old. Maybe he needs glasses, you know, missing some skill shots.
It's the new haircut.
But it is the pressure. They're trying to just force SK back, and it's something that Fnatic, and I actually think Millennium, do more than any other team when they run Ziggs. They're not afraid to use their ultimates to simply get presence and pressure on the tower. So while Fnatic are pushing middle, Reckless is pushing top. He's got an Infinity Edge to back up his Ghostblade and Blade of the Ruined King. Nobody can deal with him at all. Candy Pan is going to be very careful if he tries to wave clear against Reckless's Vayne.
Yeah, he's actually leaving that wave to just crash against the tower. It looks like he's going to let it go. Of course, they do have the Baron buff on them. It's just about to wear off, a feel. And see, he's got about a minute 30 still on it, actually. So Yellowstar looking to try and land one of those killer death sentences he's been throwing out. And Anyone it lands on tends to go down. He's only down to a 90% participation rate because unfortunately he wasn't involved in the two kills, sorry, that Candy Panera's suffered.
Yeah, Yellow Star, why are you so bad? But he's been in the right place at the right time. And honestly, we said this yesterday and I'm going to say it again.
Oh, that was better.
His Thresh is absolutely incredible. He's still got the Talisman of Ascension. Fnatic finally land the damage they need to secure the inner turret. And Soez was actually pushing the wave up on the bottom lane. So if they wanted to peel bottom, they could. Instead, Fnatic stay grouped up. And Soez just takes one or two extra turret shots. I mean, there's very little that SK can do to stop them.
He's got the armor and regen to do it, and he's quite happy to just sustain his way through there. Death Sentence not quite catching on. That does mean, of course, the wave's going to come in. Rekkles gets himself a couple more free shots. They go for him. They knock him back. This is good control. He's ignited, but he gets a good heal straight off. Freddy now in trouble. He's going to get caught out. Cyanide comes around the side. Candy Panner did manage to get himself one kill onto Soez, but Sven Skjern paid the price. He was the man that dived in amongst the team, and it was a one-for-one trade.
The fight is about 15 minutes too late for SK Gaming. You see how much damage was put down into Rekkles that quickly. The Shockwave, as well as the Assault and Battery, obliterated Rekkles' hit points. But because SK are so far behind, they couldn't stick around. They couldn't stay in the fight. They end up trading one for one, which is actually good for SK, because they're getting some more gold from killing Soez. But you have to feel it's just a little too late. Unfortunately for SK, they've been pushed all the way back to their inhibitor turrets in two lanes, and they're 14,000 gold down.
Where do they go from here? Fnatic get it back and buy. Another bomb thrown out to the top. Wipes it out. Gets himself another stack of minions. 416 inside 34 minutes. Peke just been farming up a storm. Meanwhile, 605 for Rekkles is a killing machine. Anyone with fantasy points will be hoping this game goes on much longer, I think. Because, well, at least unless you've got Fnatic on your team. If you've got SK, won't be so pretty for you, that's for sure.
I just happened to have Sven Skjern and Jezzers on my fantasy team. So well played, Freak. Congratulations on your win. Not having a very good week, unfortunately.
That's okay. I'm going down to Jat this week. doesn't look good for either of us.
N-A-O-P, it appears. But not quite sure what Yellowstar was doing with that death sentence. But Fnatic, they've just got even more items. Banshee's Velcro. I mean, Sven doesn't even throw Assault and Battery. Oh, it wasn't available, actually.
Yeah.
Wasn't able to catch him down. But yeah, Banshee's Veil completed now for Rekkles. So that very big engage we seen a few minutes ago under the turret will be much more difficult to pull off. The pressure is going to be on Candy Panda to pop the Banshee's Veil like he just did. One of those missiles and instantly down. But look at Soez, split pushing with teleport available. Again, it's so difficult. Very few people can deal with him or contain him. So keep playing the map and Fnatic will create a window of opportunity where they will punish SK Gaming.
He's actually playing around Freddy as well. He's not getting involved with him. Now he may have to. Candy Panda's moving across here. He's going to try and cut him off. Pings in towards him. Soez going to get locked up. Explosive cast goes down there. He's going to drag him to center away. Kicks that burnout. Candy Panda tries to race in towards him, but not close enough.
No, Dragon's Descent was always going to be powerful enough. With the burnout movement speed and the Blade of the Rune King and Arandion's Omen, SK Gaming did not have the hard CC for that gank to make any sense. They need Vi to get in there. They need Vi to lock him down, otherwise it's simply not going to work out.
Not going to lie, I thought Soez looked a little bored down the bottom. I was like, oh, they tried to kill me. I don't know what they were thinking.
He's playing a Bruiser. You know how Soez feels about playing Bruiser.
I know.
He's very well... very outspoken about that. But again, another invade from Fnatic. They may be waiting for the next Baron buff. It feels like Fnatic don't want to tower dive, and you have to think that inhibitor turret fight was a rude awakening for Fnatic because of how close they were to actually losing Rekkles. So with that in mind, a little hint of caution can go a long way, and Fnatic will look to grab another Baron buff before potentially making another.
Oh, jungler caught out. Sven Skjern locked up. Takes a lot of damage. Forced away from that one. Just at the point that the Baron is spawning. Remember the two top laners, Soez and Freddy, have teleport available if they want to get into this one. There is Rekkles starting out, taking down that Baron.
Whoa!
Mega Inferno Bomb doing exactly what it describes. It does a mega amount of damage. And Sven Skjern cannot take the bouncing bomb. Enraith is going to get locked up. Rekkles chases on towards him. He gets plunked off the map. And Rekkles gets himself another kill. Honestly, I'm not sure SK can stop anything now that Fnatic can throw at them.
No, they can't. They haven't been able to for a while. And that Mega Inferno Bomb from Peke, did so much damage. Not only are Fnatic going to get the Baron, they get the teleport out of Freddy. They're going to get Freddy as well.
Freddy, of course, has that explosive casket. Could be enough to maybe try and take it down, but he's having to use it in defense. Reckless will get caught out. He's no longer the Immortal. He will go down. Candyman, oh, where was that flash going? Don't know. Didn't work out for him. Pekka gets the kill and locks him down. They didn't get Baron, though. Oh, they did. They finished it off as well.
Yeah,
they got everything.
Baron secured. Inner turret on the bottom lane. Teleport taken from Freddy. Even though Reckless goes down, because Candy Panda does have a lot of good items, IH, Trinity Force, and Last Whisper, it just feels like too little, too late, I'm afraid. There's still 17,000 gold separating these two teams. And with Baron up and with the amount of damage you've seen Pekka putting down, you have to feel they're just going to siege. They can just sit in front of a tower, throw bombs out, and when a bomb lands, with Vayne and with Shyvana, they can melt through towers very, very quickly.
In times like this, you need your carriers to do something spectacular, pull out something incredible. Candy Panda has got 4 of the 5 kills for SK Gaming, whereas Jezzers is on 0-0-1, 38 minutes into the game.
That is a massive problem when you have an Orianna. Command Protect, Command Distance, you have a shield, you have a movement speed increase, you have a ball delivery system in Vi that is guaranteed to find its target. And as long as Jezzers is pressing R at the right time, he's not going to be out of range for the shockwaves. The problem is, SK simply have not put themselves in positions where they could team fight. They got bullied and they got pushed behind and pushed back so far. I would dare say they've been running scared. I would dare say they have not looked a challenge. And once Fnatic got ahead, SK have made very little plays. They haven't really challenged around Dragon. They haven't really challenged around their blue buff. And when you've got a team that needs to team fight because you've got this very innate synergy between 4 of your 5 champions, and you've got the safety net in Gragas, when you bite off more you can chew, it's just unfortunate, you know? SK really, really on a downward spiral.
Yeah, this is another big loss for them, of course. That would make it 0-2 for this week, not what they wanted, but Fnatic, they're going to continue their winning ways here, it seems, unless something incredible is pulled out from SK Gaming. And it really will have to be an absolute immaculate play from SK at this situation, this point in time, because this man on your screen right now, Reckless, is a killing machine on Vayne. It's been a long time since we saw a Vayne, honestly, but this is the man that absolutely can pull it off and is pulling it off to great effect.
Mechanically, one of the best AD carries in all of Europe. And if you just see how well he's positioned this game, you know,
so is going
wherever he wants to.
Oh, he's diving in. That's going to be Mega Inferno Bomb. And Rated will go down. Soez on towards him. Cyanide gets locked up and takes down. In comes Reckless, cleaning house. Gets one, gets two. Soez gets himself a third. Freddy goes down to a Pekka. And just like that, Fnatic turn it on and decide, you know what? Let's finish the damn game. They're going to go on another win streak. It's 6 for Fnatic as they take down SK Gaming.
And SK really having a torrid time of this one, completely shut out. We're talking about SK couldn't make plays, but all props to Fnatic. They invaded, they conquered, they dictated the pace. And there was little chance for SK to actually counter because of how great Fnatic controlled that game.
Fantastic performance. 9-1-8 for Reckless there. 0-1-19 for Yellowstar, involved in just about everything that happened. 6-0-8 for Pekka, 4-0-11 for Cyanide, 3-4-8. So I was honestly the feeder of the team, but he was in his own little game, I think, in that one. Of all people on that team, he's probably going to be the least happy, that's for sure. Big smiles all around, though, for Pekka and Reckless, of course. Another fantastic performance by Fnatic, and their fans out there will be very happy. You can see Soez, he's got a big cheer on his face as well. So they're going to be going home very happy and continuing their chase up the top of the table. And Alliance, they better be looking over their shoulders right now, because Fnatic are coming for them.
There's a 2-game difference. Alliance is sitting at 14 wins and 6 losses, while Fnatic are 13 and 7. So if Fnatic pick up one more game against Alliance, they're going to be tied at the top of the table. On the same token, SK continue to fall down the rungs. They are now tied with the Super Hot Crew at 11 and 9. And considering how strong SK were looking towards the end of the last split, and even some of the games at the beginning of this split, there's something going very, very wrong in that camp. I do want to say that in this game, I was looking at Svenskeren and Candy Panda as my players to watch, as the players that needed to carry. Candy stepped up. Sven had little to no impact. Whether that's the champion, whether that's his individual performance, you can argue. But he really had little impact in slowing or stopping Fnatic.
6 deaths in his match yesterday, 7 deaths today. That's not good reading for your jungler.
And no.
That's a bit of a problem.
Incredible problems. And this is one of the problems that I was saying in the pregame with regards to Candy Panda. He's had more deaths in the last 3 weeks than he did in the first 5. And you can argue that's bad positioning, or you can argue that's his team not being able to protect him. And when you've got your jungler that's giving up 13 deaths in 2 games, obviously there's a very big case to Candy Panda just doesn't have the front line that he needs.
Big, big grins you can see there. Aaron Ayer also on the screen, of course. He is now the coach of Fnatic and may well like to claim a fair bit of the input to the 6 wins that Fnatic may well have picked up and surged. And we had him, I was talking to him yesterday actually, as Fnatic were in the pick and ban phase. They'd got 3 of the 5 that they knew that were coming. It was the important ones, more importantly as well, that they got the bans and picks for. They knew what they were up against in those lane phases. And, you know, that's a big part. If you know already in your head they're going to be picking this just by simply researching, it gives you a big advantage.
Of course it does, because it helps tailor your action plan. In this game, it was very clear. Fnatic wanted to dive the top lane. They wanted to keep Freddy out of it. They dove him twice, and yes, they lost one dragon, but they challenged for everything else, and then they counter-jungled enough to make up that early deficit. So a very good game plan and well executed.
Fantastic stuff so far. And Fnatic, they continue their charge at the top of the table. Let's go over and hear from them. Shox is standing by with Peke and Cyanide after that win.
Thank you very much, D-Man. Guys, 6-0 winning streak right now, resembling some of the things you've done a little earlier before it went a little bit downhill. It seems like you absolutely found your form. And I think that's also reflected in maybe one particular pick, the Vayne for Reckless. When did you decide you wanted to go for that one?
It just that they banned Lucian, so he wanted to play Vayne since the comp was good for it.
Well, go a little bit more in depth, because 280 carry ban is not something we see that often. And actually, it should have been a ban for a lot longer for teams to ban out that Lucian for Reckless. So where did you go from there building your comp?
Well, there are a lot of AD carries that are really strong right now. Like you can see, Lucian is really strong when it comes to skills. Corki is pretty much the same. And then you have other kind of AD carries, Caitlyn, Kog'Maw, that has a lot of damage. The thing is that Reckless plays Lucian so good that he always preferred to play it, but he can do as good on Vayne or on Corki or on Caitlyn or whatever. So I think other teams knew that it was no point to ban Lucian because he would play something else, and it's better to try to ban someone else. I don't know, they tried to ban me or Cyanide or Soa sometimes, but SK decided to try to ban Lucian, and they realized that it was not worth it anyways.
All right, Cyanide, tell me what you focused on going into the early game, because actually SK was not doing that bad in the early game, and you guys opted for the lane swap to make it safer, Reckless.
So yeah, we had a Vayne lane, so you normally have to lane swap in that case to get a Vayne a free lane. And well, I just tried to focus on not giving them the early dragons, and we managed to get some picks and let's just secure them all. So it went pretty well for us.
So Peke, you opted for that Ziggs. There were some minor changes to Ziggs in the recent patch. Not going for that Syndra, something you have been going for so many times before, so why is that?
I didn't know they changed anything on Ziggs, so I don't care. No. I don't care about Ziggs. I didn't even think I was gonna play him. We thought they were gonna ban him, and I was hoping that they ban him because I prefer to play other stuff, but they left it open, and I was like, okay, let's go for Ziggs, because Ziggs is a safe champion. You can play aggressive, you can play defensive, and let's say they had Ziggs this game, it would have taken 20 more minutes to finish, even if you had advantage. So we decided to go for it first, and then just pick the rest, because there was nothing, no other position that we will get out of picks. We had 2 junglers, a lot of top laners, enough AD carries, enough supports.
One more thing about that, Ziggs, because I was chatting to Aranea for a bit, and he was very angry with you because you already had the Rabadons and the Zhonyas, yet you still bought the needlessly large rod.
I had no money.
And then
for
you
anything.
Sold it, and he was actually very angry with you. So
because I had like 1600 gold exactly, so I cannot buy a Void Staff already, I cannot buy Leech Bane. And I wanted a lot of AP, so I just bought the biggest item, and then I don't want to make a DFE because that's, I think, too troll. I would have made it, but I think it's too troll. So I just sold it to get the Lich Bane so we could push faster.
But he was quite angry with you nonetheless, and I feel that that's a sign that he still cares very much. Even if it seems that you guys will be winning games, he's still writing down every mistake. And we've asked a couple of players in the team already, Cyanide, what the effect has been from RNA on the team. What has it been for you?
Of course, he can help me a lot since he's a jungler himself, so he gives me some tips or whatever, or he knows every time I do something wrong, which is really annoying because he always points it out, but I try to correct my mistakes the best I can.
Well, actually, to be honest, I found that in the recent weeks, it seems that you're always a very steady jungler, but in the recent weeks, it seems that you have found that synergy with the different players a lot more than you have before. You've gone in for those smite steals again. So what is it that has enabled you to step up in these last few weeks?
I think we are just all playing better, and then you can make like a lot of plays. Like now that the support is roaming a lot, I have good synergy with Yellow Star, and we can just coordinate all kinds of buff steals and stuff. So yeah, I think we just have a really good synergy from practicing a lot.
All right, taking a step back at the standings, Peke. In an interview in the beginning of the split, I believe you said, I think it's going to be Alliance, Gambit, and Fnatic that's going to be the top three going in the playoffs. Would you like to revise that that statement? How do you think things are going to go now?
The same thing. Gambit for life. Gambit! No, it's a bit sad, but I thought they would get back, you know? Like, kind of like us, like, even if they didn't make it to the top, I thought they would get back on track and at least be a force to reckon, but they didn't, and instead they changed players, and I think they are just going worse and worse, and I don't know. Yeah, I change it, for sure. I'll put SK or Super Hot Crew over Gambit, for sure, now.
Oh, very interesting. Saina, what do you think? A mention for Super Hot Crew here by Peke.
I think us and Alliance, and then the third one is going to be difficult. Like Rocket is playing really well, but yeah, it might be a bit hard for them to make it now. Well, in the playoffs, I think they have a chance to make it to the playoffs if they keep playing like this.
What's
like
the chance that you guys will end up number one?
A lot of chance.
A lot of chance.
we are tied number one, no?
Not yet.
Or one win behind?
Yeah, one win behind Alliance.
Too bad, I guess. They just have to keep losing.
All right, well.
If they keep losing, we can, for
let's
sure.
Let's stop it right here. Congratulations, guys. Congratulations on that 6-0 winning streak, and thank you very much. Let's flash back over to D-Man and Quickshot for a look at the standings.
Thank you very much, Shock, Cyanide, and Peke. So here are where the teams currently sit. Peke, you may want to take note of these tables, by the way. It is one win away. Alliance, they do continue to hold first place, although that lead is indeed dwindling with two losses this week. And they are on a four-game losing streak now. They're 14-6. Meanwhile, Fnatic, you're not top yet. They are extending their win streak to six wins in a row. But of course, they are second place now. 13 wins, 7 losses.
We do have a tie in third place, where SK Gaming and the Super Hot Crew are now 11-9. Millennium has slipped into fifth in a tie with the Rising Rocket, who are on a 5-game winning streak. They're both at 10 wins and 10 losses. And I do want to mention, Gambit is now 0-7. In the LCS, and they need to find some synergy quickly.
Yeah, those changes not working out just yet. Of course, those 8 matches this week, there are a number of players that we want to select for our OP team. In the top lane, well, we think none other than the man that's just played. Soaz has played fantastic this week.
Yeah, his Shyvana was very good in split pushing, helped end the game, but it was his Gragas yesterday that really stood out for me. It was against Maima on Mundo, and he just smashed Maima in the laning phase.
Well, in the jungle, it's not his partner, it's the man from Rocket. It is Jankos. He's been involved in everything so far. 2 first bloods once again. Rocket getting the most first bloods actually this week as well, I believe. And they had 11 kills this week as well. Fantastic performance.
Very, very strong play. Jankos has always been a dominant jungler when on form, but he's a little bit inconsistent. So it's good to see an aggressive in-your-face Jankos securing kills for his team.
Especially since he played Vi as well this week, working out well for him. Mid lane is another man, his main man in the mid lane. It is Overpower once again. Absolutely the best mid laner this week.
He had the highest KDA out of all of Europe at 8.33. He played Fizz for the first time against Syndra. He played Gragas in the mid lane for the first time in Europe up against Yasuo. Strong performances and strong positional play against both of his enemies.
Yeah, no, us against SK and Alliance's performances as well. Fantastic stuff. AD carry, well, it's the man from the Wolves. It's Warlight. He has been phenomenal this week, really turning things around, even wearing a fedora in an interview.
Yes, very, very strong. Is it a fedora or a bowler? We'll discuss that another time. Regardless, his level was great. Another strong showing, Corki into Lucian and Lucian versus Caitlyn. I do want to give special mention to a few other AD carries as well. Kreaton on Ezreal, Reckless on Vayne. Yep. But it was Warlight that shone in a team that is struggling when he needs to step up. He's delivering for the Wolves, helping them maybe get closer to 6.
Well, with another Impressive victory for Rocket. Of course, we're looking towards Vander as the support. He had 31 assists this week. It's the most in week 8.
Yeah, and if memory serves, he went unkilled yesterday and gave up 2 deaths today. Again, very strong play. I'm sad that he's not playing Thresh, because earlier this year, I felt he was one of the strongest Thresh players. But you know what? He's transitioned that skill into his Braum, into his Nami, and he's just delivering again and again against multiple opponents.
Yeah, we should have a couple of honorable mentions, because there's been some great supports this week. Unlimited for the Wolves, of course, alongside Warlight, picked up 21 assists himself. And Yellowstar, who we just saw there, 24 assists overall. Some fantastic play from the supports this week.
I feel like a broken record because I praise Yellowstar's Thresh on a weekly basis, but how can you not? He delivers every single time. His death sentences, his lanterns, and his positioning.
Well, of all those players, we have to pick an MVP. And this week, we have selected a member of the Rising Rocket. And this time, it's the man in the jungle. It is Jankos.
Yeah, so again, really just want to praise his impact to the team. Without Jankos creating the opportunities, Rocket are seldom going to be able to make aggressive plays. And I feel now that he's making the plays and he's got the support of his team around jungles, around the lanes, things are working out for Rocket. He definitely is a leading force when it comes to starting fights and starting engagements. This week, it worked out for Rocket.
Yeah, that being one of the first bloods in the top lane against Wicked. Fantastic stuff, ladies and gentlemen. Week 8 of the League of Legends Champion Series will be continuing tomorrow in the North America, starting with Complexity versus Curse. A big one, because those two teams went huge in the Super Weeks, of course. And then it's going to be followed by Evil Geniuses up against Cloud9.
That will be followed by Counter-Logic Gaming as they take on Team Solo Mid. LMQ will then take on Team Dignitas. And after those matches, the North American Challenger Series takes over with a quarterfinal best of 3 between Team Coast and Denial Esports. Those matches start on Saturday at 9 p.m. Central European Summertime, which is 12 noon Pacific.
I'm excited to see how long the ties can continue in North America. I'm going to be keeping my eye on that one for sure. Next week, of course, the European LCS will continue right here in Cologne, Germany, as the Super Hot Crew will be taking on Rocket. That's a game you will not want to miss, that's for sure. And then Gambit will be going up against Alliance.
That will be followed by Fnatic versus the Copenhagen Wolves and SK Gaming versus Millennium.
That will all be starting next Thursday at 5 p.m. Central European Summertime, 9 a.m. Pacific. I'm pretty sure that's 6 p.m.
Should
actually.
Be 6 p.m.
I'm
yeah.
pretty sure that should be 6 p.m., not 5 p.m. Right after the LCS preview show, we'll be kicking things off, of course. That's going to be half an hour before at 5:30. That does it for us, of course. Thank you very much for watching. Stay tuned, though, for the European Challenger Series quarterfinals that will be kicking off right now between Ninjas in Pajamas facing the Unicorns of Love.
You, but me and Nef got a good cheer.
Oh, I got no cheer.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, they're intimidated by my muscles.
Nidalee bot.
Can he finish up Vander? It's Townsend against the kill, but Froggen will be hunted
they
down. Wicked down
they
in as well. Sullivan down towards Townsend. Gets that one. Wicked's going to go down as well. This is surely the game for Froggen.
No. Anything but Yorick. I really don't want to play against it. Oh my god. Like,
okay, it's just meant.
There's one thing I don't want to play against.
Can they actually get the kill? A lot of damage. Here comes the rest of the team. Nick's going to go down as well. And this is a problem for Gambit once again. So low and limited fantasy, and he may well get it. Oh, the Sonic Wave belly slammed away there. The ultimate comes out from Cortex. He's going to take a lot of culinary wax this time around. Curbs is running for his life, and he may well be able to get away. He goes back aggressive onto with limited, takes him down. Oh, he's diving in. That's going to be Mega Inferno Bomb. And Rated will go down. Soez on towards him. Cyanide gets locked up and takes down. In comes Reckless. Cleaning house. Gets one, gets two. Soez gets himself a third. Freddy goes down to a Peke.